Good afternoon. On behalf of Mayor Stephen Fulop and the Jersey City Municipal Council, welcome to the Michael Yoon Memorial Event here at City Hall on the second day of April 2022. Let's start the afternoon with a moment of silence and prayer. Please rise. Thank you. Please remain standing as I welcome, I introduce Michael Yoon's oldest grandson, William, and my daughter, Sarah, who will lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance. My name is David Diaz, and today I serve as an assistant business administrator for the city. For nearly two decades, I was the director of the Central Avenue SID, where I worked closely with Michael Yoon while he was president of the organization and later became councilman. Michael is someone I consider a dear friend and inspiring mentor. I just want to take a moment to thank the Yoon family for the honor of being here with you all today. I know Michael is smiling down on us as we come together to share his stories and celebrate his memory. He was one of a kind and truly a Jersey City legend. Before Mayor Fulop gives his welcoming remarks, I want to personally thank him, Cultural Affairs Director Christine Goodman, and her amazing staff for honoring Michael today. April 6th will be the two-year anniversary of his passing. Michael was taken from us at the height of the pandemic, when social distancing restrictions prevented his friends, families, and members of the community the opportunity to come together. Thank you, Mayor, for bringing us all here today. Please give a warm welcome to Jersey City Mayor Stephen Fulop.
I'm not doing this now, right? The proclamation is later?
No, I wasn't planning it.
Thank you, and please be seated. I know we have a full program, and a lot of people are going to speak about their interactions with Michael. There isn't a person in this room that Michael didn't help or touch personally. I can tell you from the Jersey City standpoint, he really embodied the best that this city has to offer. He was an immigrant, he was a business owner, he was a family man, he was a believer and fighter for the city, and a believer and a fighter for what he thought was the right thing to do. Politically speaking, Michael was a fierce and tough opponent. He was smart as they come, he was an advocate, and I think when he first ran for office, few in the political class thought they had a chance to win, and we all learned the hard way multiple times that Michael never quits and Michael perseveres. Today is a bittersweet day because we're able to recognize him, so we're happy that we're able to do it, but at the same time, we're sad that we're under these conditions, a life lost way too soon. So on behalf of all the people in Jersey City, I just want to say thank you for coming out today. We have a very extensive speaking list of people that he's touched over the decades of service here in Jersey City, and some great musical performances that he helped organize here in Jersey City. So again, thank you, our condolences to the family, and please thank you for coming out today, and rest in peace, Michael.
Thank you, Mayor. Michael believed that government should work for the people it serves. As councilman for Ward D, he worked vigorously to assist his constituents on the street and represent their interests in the council meetings. The city council agenda and all of its attachments can be several hundred pages long, and Michael was well known for showing up to the caucus meetings with tons of notes and highlighter on every page. He paid close attention to detail, was very thoughtful in his process, and pushed good ideas to be better. When making a point, one of Michael's favorite go-to phrases was, "I scratched my head." If you're a city official on the receiving end of that discussion, and you knew you were in trouble upon hearing those words. His passion to serve Jersey City well created some spirited debates at times and made the city council meetings interesting, to say the least. The Difficult work he and his colleagues did on the City Council for nearly 7 years proved to make Jersey City better today for its residents, seniors, businesses, taxpayers, and visitors alike. I am grateful to see so many of the City Council members here today who served with Michael and continue to push Jersey City forward. I would like to introduce Council at Large, Amy DeGees. Please come share a few words. Thanks.
Thank you for all being here today. I've known Michael since I was a very little girl. I spent a lot of time in his store, and I heard him all day talking to people, trying to fix problems, make their lives easier and better, and getting nothing in return. And it made him and his wife and his family feel very, very good. I hope that we all continue to have a piece of that in our heart and that we continue his work and continue his legacy. Thank you.
Councilwoman Prinzeri.
Good afternoon, everyone. It's humbling to be here to celebrate Michael's life. He made a huge impression on all of the council. I remember when I first came on, I would get text messages with notes, and it would take me about 20 minutes to read through. He was always diligent, he was always thoughtful, he was always respectful. When there were conflicts on the council, he would bring us together up to his office in the Heights and have tea. And I always remember that moving forward. And that is the kind of man that Michael was, and that's the kind of impression he made to make us better and do more. So the family, we're here for you, to support you as always, and to celebrate a man who lived a very, very rich life.
Thank you. Just a reminder to shut off your cell phones. Thank you. Next, I would like to invite Councilman Boggiano to say a few words.
I sat next to Michael up here on the council for 4 or 5 years. And I'll tell you, I miss Michael. I miss him today more than ever. And I got to say something. I used to go up to the store on Central Avenue, and Mrs. Young over here was so nice to me. She used to bring me cookies, soda, candy, and I miss going up there. It was great. But Mr. and Mrs. Young, both of them were fantastic. And Michael and I worked together over the years, and he was a true inspiration and a true Jersey City person. And Mrs. Young, I miss Michael a lot. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilman. Next up, I would like to introduce Councilman Yosef Saleh.
It's my humble and solemn honor to stand here before you today to remember and celebrate the memory of Michael, late Councilman Michael Yoon. I had the solemn honor and duty of taking over his position after he had passed away, being appointed right in the middle of the pandemic. And, you know, it was very, very large shoes to fill. And I would soon realize how large of those shoes they were when I would go out into the community. But my first memory of the late Councilman Michael Yoon was when he was a store owner and I was a little kid. My mom would go to Garden State News, and every week she'd go and get the Jersey Journal. Back then, they had coupons inside, and you know, as a first-generation son of immigrants, we would go to his store to get those coupons. I have 7 sisters, and she would clip those coupons. You know, we're trying to make ends meet, and that was one of the ways we would. And then as I get older, I would go to his store to get the gamer magazines. There'd be cheat codes, you know, for the video games. And then as I got older, I got my first crush, a Beanie Baby toy from his store as well. This was back in middle school. And, you know, I didn't know when I was a kid how important the late Councilman Michael Yoon was, how integral he was to the community, how he started the Central Avenue SID, how he was integral in fighting for the preservation of the reservoir. And when I got older and I saw him as a councilman and I saw his legislative accomplishments, you know, he would protect the seniors, he would protect animal rights, and he was very fiscally minded. And his business acumen was, you know, head above shoulders anybody else. So when the pandemic hit, I was sitting at home, I was playing my Nintendo Switch, and I, like everyone, was shocked at the scale and the breadth of what was happening. And I think when Councilman Michael Yoon passed away, it really hit home at the reality of what we are facing 2 years ago today. I don't think any of us anticipated it, and it was a complete shock to the entire community. And then when I wasn't appointed, I had to go out and canvass the community, and some people that hadn't heard the news, that might not have had access or internet, I would tell them, I'm the councilman for the Heights, and they said, no, it's Councilman Michael Yoon. And I would say, I'm really, really sorry, you know, and I'm masked up, they can't see, all they can see is my eyes, that I'm telling them that, you know, I'm really, really sorry, but Councilman Michael Yoon passed away, and I couldn't comfort them, and it was really heartbreaking just to see the number of people, and this happened numerous times when I was out in the Heights, and I just had a sense of how much he was beloved by everyone across every corner of the Heights. And every time I would run into someone and have to tell them, it made me realize that the community didn't really have the opportunity to grieve. We didn't have the opportunity to talk about his accomplishments and what kind of man he was and what kind of a public servant he was. And you know, he wore the bow tie and it became his symbol, and I think it was a symbol of his professionalism, a symbol of how he was a servant of the people, a symbol of the class he brought to the position. And you know, we must continue his legacy, and that's what I've tried to do as the councilman, to continue his legacy for Central Avenue. There's so many projects. We have the reservoir that's being renovated. He was so passionate about the ecological preservation of that site. Central Avenue is getting a new streetscape. This is the brainchild of Michael Yoon, the late councilman. He had dreamt this, he had fought for it, and he had pushed it as far as he could push it, and it was ready. It was like the cake was ready to come out the oven, and that was, you know, it was his accomplishments. And you know, we are forever grateful. His legacy continues to this day. He's the epitome of the American dream. You know, to come here and start a business and to give back to his community and to be so beloved, it is something worth striving for. He's proof positive that the American dream continues today, but only because he sent the elevator back down to the next generation, to the community. He said, I was given so much, and to whom much is given, much is earned. You have to give it back to the community that gave it to you. And today we give him and his family all the love and all the respect and all the honor for everything that he did. And may we continue to honor his memory, tread lightly upon this earth, but talk passionately for every issue in our community. Thank you.
Well said. Thank you, Councilman. And we have Councilman James Solomon as well.
You know, echoing the remarks of my colleagues, you know, Michael truly was, you know, the epitome of what we want in a public servant. And, you know, one of my last conversations with Michael, we were on a conference call with the postmaster of the U.S. Postal Service. And Michael was really giving it to the postmaster. And postmaster wasn't doing right by the people of Jersey City, and Michael was going to have none of it. And so he was fighting to get parking spaces returned back to the people in the Heights. And I think of that story because I think it just epitomizes how Michael was behind closed doors exactly the same as he was in the public and was always fighting for those things. Then you never question with Michael his integrity and his heart and what he was trying to fight for. David referenced every single council meeting. Michael read every page, hundreds to thousands of pages every 2 weeks. He read every single one. And he would come to the meetings with suggestions. Hey, if we change the way that we're doing our credit card reimbursements, we're going to save taxpayers $100. And that was never too small for Michael, because he was there to serve people. And, you know, the highest compliment, you know, I think I can offer is we deeply miss him on the council. We have 9 great public servants on the council, but no one could replace Michael, not any 9 of us. And as a city, it was a real loss for his tragic passing. And as obviously my heart goes out to the family as well. And I just, you know, it's just great to be able to have all of us here to share our memories and to really celebrate a true son of Jersey City. Thank you.
At this time, I would like to invite Jennifer and Michael's immediate family to please come up.
We have a proclamation, and we want to present to you before the Philharmonic plays. And I think that you have some brief comments here from the council members just speaking to Michael's impact overall. I can tell you anecdotally, about 2.5 years ago, my wife and I made a reservation. It sticks out of my head because we thought it was symbolic of who Michael is. Made a reservation for a dinner in Fort Lee, and put the last name full up. I've been the mayor at this point for 7 years, and we went there, and she said, "Oh, you're from Jersey City." And we said, "Yes," and I thought she was gonna say something about being the mayor, and she said, "Do you know Michael Young?" And I said, "Yeah," just very famous, very famous. And I said, "Okay, he's a great guy." But that is the truth. And look, the reality is that, like Youssef said, Michael had an impact on the city that was very significant. In our business of elected officials and politics, it's really about communication. You really need to be able to communicate with the public and articulate a message and advocate for something. And if you think about Michael as an immigrant coming in that had language barriers versus everybody else here who was American born, and he had a thick accent, didn't speak perfect English, yet he was able to transcend and overcome that and get elected by the public in huge numbers. So you have to think about how hard that is to do as an elected official with your biggest tool is communication. That's ultimately what it is. It's communicating and articulating something. And the only reason he was able to do that was because people trusted him. They knew where his heart was, and that he articulated over 20, 30, 40 years here in Jersey City, really the fact that he cares about people. When he had events, whether it was for Christmas or Thanksgiving or anything at the store, if you didn't see it personally, I can tell you the line was for blocks long, and it was just free gifts that they would give out to make sure that everybody had a good holiday. He was doing that before he was an elected official. Most people do that after they're an elected official to try and stay there. And that's the reality. He did it for years and years for nothing other than making sure that people had a better holiday here in Jersey City. You see some of the seniors here. I just want to say as well, there was no better advocate for the senior community than Michael Young. He was at the forefront of every single event before he was an elected official there. There was no better advocate for the Korean War veterans in Jersey City than Michael Young. When they tried to move that memorial down on Washington Street, it was Michael that stopped that. There was no better advocate for the business community on Central Avenue. When they tried to do things that would adverse, bring big competitor, big box retailers into Jersey City, it was Michael that organized against them. So why do I say all that? Because the reality of the situation is that when you think about the tools that we have, which is communication, ultimately able to articulate a message clearly, right? And Michael came in with a handicap on that. He was an immigrant that it wasn't his first language. And he overcame that in a way that not only marginally he won with big numbers again and again. It really is a testament to his skill, his talent, and ultimately who he was. Look, we have here a proclamation that we wanted to present to the family just because it's more important than actually the glass or the paper that it's on. It's really to memorialize that as long as this city hall is here and as long as that clerk office is there, that Michael Yun will be memorialized in that office forever. And that's really what these ceremonies are about. So long after today and long after next year, when people are enjoying the reservoir and Central Avenue is finished and they want to do a little bit of research on who the difference makers are, they'll know that Michael Yun was here. So on behalf of all of us in Jersey City, I know these times are painful, and I know it's not easy, but we all do miss Michael, and we want to say thank you for lending him to us here in Jersey City to make it a better place. Thank you.
Just make them time. Okay, before we continue on with our list of speakers, we'd like to invite the Jersey City Philharmonica Orchestra to play a Mozart Cornet Quintet, K581, in a major second movement. Thank you. Thank you. Next up on our list of speakers is another Jersey City Heights guy. I would like to introduce County Executive Tom DeGise.
Thank you. And I've been doing a fair share of public speaking throughout my career, close to 30 years. But I don't think I've ever followed the Philharmonic Orchestra before. It's a little bit daunting. I also just wanted to quickly mention that having been the council president here for 8 years, and mostly during the 1990s, this place looks beautiful. Years ago, we had garbage cans down here catching the holes in the roof, releasing water, and it's come a long way, and I congratulate Mayor Fulop and the City Council for taking good care of this gem. Michael Young was a friend of mine. Michael and I go back a long time, another incarnation. I was a real estate salesman, and I worked on Central Avenue, one long block away from where Garden State News is. There are two little anecdotes that will shed a little bit of light, I think, on the man. I came in there, and you got to understand, if you haven't seen the store of Garden State News, you can get anything there. You know, you got your newspapers there, you got your magazines, you got your candy, soda, chips, greeting cards, and everybody from the Heights went there. So if you went there, you don't know who you're going to bump into, but you know you're going to bump into someone. So I ambled in to buy something from Michael, and Michael said, "Your daughter is here." And I turned around and looked. I didn't see anybody. "In the back," he said, "she's in the back." So I walked in the back, and there are three tweeners, I think they call them, about 12, 13 years old, sitting on the floor, having magazines out, and they're cruising around looking for pictures of Justin Timberlake. Their pay was that they had a bag of potato chips that they shared and a can of soda that they shared. And I said, "Amy," you know, I gave it away, which daughter it was on that one too. I said, "You can't stand, you know, not spend money in the man's store and, you know, look at all the magazines." And Michael came back, "Leave them alone. They're good kids. I don't mind them being here. They're okay." That was the first lesson for Michael. Central Avenue around the late 70s into the early 80s was not thriving. There were empty stores on almost every block. Everybody complained about the proliferation of the 99-cent stores, one after another. And Michael decided that he was going to do something about it. And that was the first time I heard of an SID, a Special Improvement District. Michael was the president of the Central Avenue Businessmen, tried to explain to his members that we have to do it. There was a general feeling among many of the other merchants, "Hey, we pay taxes here. You know, the city should be taking care of the sidewalks, of the streets, of the advertising and everything." And Michael said, "Well, we've been waiting for them to do that for a long time, and they haven't done it. We should do it ourselves." So he was basically asking them to put a special tax on themselves. It wasn't a very popular idea. Michael went from store to store, from North Street all the way down to Manhattan Avenue, trying to convince the merchants that his plan would help bring Central Avenue back. It was a tough one, and when the vote came, Michael's argument won. And the SID was born under that kind of fire there. And if we were to go up to Central Avenue and Bower Street right now on a Saturday afternoon with the sun out, you wouldn't see too many vacant stores. You'd see families and people walking to the brand new bakeries and stores that are there. There is no longer a proliferation of the 99-cent store, and this was Michael. And the sad part about his leaving us is that he's just getting started. I had several meetings with him and my county executives to talk about common needs and wants and how we could work together. And I was tremendously impressed with his knowledge of the issues. I knew about his persuasiveness already, and his ability to really cut to the chase in topics of policy. And I thought he's going to be one of the great ones. Out of all the council people, no offense intended to anybody, but he was going to be one of the great ones. He had the work ethic, I think that James mentioned a little before. He did his homework, he worked hard, a likable man, and got along with everybody. And I was tremendously saddened to hear of his passing a couple of Aprils ago. I think for a lot of us, it really drove home the seriousness and the danger of the pandemic there. Up until that, it's kind of like getting a flu shot, make sure you take care of yourself and stay in bed. That was the one. Michael's death was the one for me, and I think of a lot of other people saying, oh my God, this is a scourge, and this is something that needs to be dealt with. And it's unfortunate that he wasn't there for the effort. But I miss him. The Avenue will always be his claim to fame, and his love, along with his family. And I think what we are doing today in honoring Michael is the right thing to do, and something that he is very worthy of. Thank you very much for allowing me to participate in your ceremony.
Thank you, Tom. Our next speaker, I believe, is running a few minutes late. I don't see him in the crowd, Bud Chandler. Well, we're going to circle back with him. Next, I invite to say a few words is Christopher Chung, from Mayor of Palisades Park.
Thank you. When I think of Councilman Yoon, the following comes to mind: a loving husband and a father, a civic community leader, and a friend. Councilman Yoon loved his wife and his sons more than anything. Family was always first. He was a family man to his core. He was my mentor, and he was a great friend. And I will forever be grateful for the intersection of our lives. He always presented his unique, strong voice for the well-being of the community, and was never afraid to advocating for a purpose he believed in. Councilman Michael Yoon was dedicated so much of his passion and life to the city of Jersey City. First elected in 2013 to present Ward D, he played an essential role in the city's recent growth and success. He always made himself available for his constituents, spending hours upon hours listening to their issues and then seeking the best solution for their pressing matters. With a wealth of wisdom and experience, he took me under his wings when I first became a councilman in 2014. He mentored and guided me despite his busy schedule, and I will forever be grateful to him for that. We shared one main idea together: our desire to serve the community at all cost, and this forged a bond that grew into a great friendship. He always wanted what was the best for the community, and I admired him for that. Mourning is a part of the grieving process. However, it is important for us to celebrate Councilman Michael Yoon's life and the examples that he set. Even in the face of adversity, he used humor and sound reasoning to keep the city moving forward. He never backed down from a challenge and was persistent in his values. He thoroughly enjoyed discussing and debating the issues of the day. But in the end, everyone knew where Councilman Yuan stood. He was going to be on the side of the investing in the future of Jersey City. Time and time again, he would lead both his supporters and his oppositions toward improvements that would bring ordinary people a better and enhanced quality of life. Councilman Michael Yuan was a tireless champion for the city of Jersey City and never stopped working to make it a better place, all while sporting a dapper bow tie, his signature item. Most importantly, he served as a critical voice to his constituents, working to always to be accessible to their needs and concerns, both big and small, even during his late illness. Thank you, Michael, Councilman Michael Yuan, for all you have done. We miss you, we love you, I treasure our friendship, and be rest assured that you'll never be forgotten. 윤유태 시의원님, 사랑합니다. Our governor, Philip Murphy, wanted to join us for the ceremony today, but because he's been tested positive, so he couldn't be here, he sent a letter, and I'd like to read that. Dear friends, I join with all of you who have gathered today to remember the remarkable life of Michael Yuan, Councilman of Jersey City. It has been 2 years since untimely passing of the beloved Michael Yuan, and yet it feels like only yesterday he was here with us. Michael was a caring, selfless individual who was loved by the community and all who knew him. As a husband, a father, and a grandfather, a business owner, an immigrant, and the first Korean American to be elected into office in Jersey City, Michael lived a life to the fullest and achieved the American dream. His passion for public service and helping people was evident in all he did to lead and inspire others. Michael's wife, Jennifer, his sons, Brian and Benjamin, and daughter-in-law, Jacqueline and Julie, and his grandchildren, William, Clara, and Juliet, have shown incredible strength this past year as we are adjusting to a world without Michael's warm laughter and encouraging spirit. On behalf of Tammy and myself, our thoughts are with Michael's family and friends as we remember all he has accomplished. My very best, Philip D. Murphy.
Thank you, Mayor Chung. Next, please welcome the former Jersey City Mayor, Brett Schundler.
I first want to apologize for Jennifer for being a little bit late all week. I've known that this was at 1 o'clock, but in my mind this morning I had it as 2 o'clock. So I was just getting dressed when the mayor texted me. Thank you, Mayor. I want to tell you about my first meeting, Michael. This was back before I was mayor, and back before Michael was the president of the Central Avenue Business Improvement District. Jersey City had qualified for the Urban Enterprise Zone benefits, but we were only getting some of the benefits that the program made communities eligible for. And it just didn't seem right to me. I was the head of a coalition of neighborhood associations, and he was very active, particularly with the Central Avenue Business Association. But he helped me from that very early time get all of the other business improvement, they weren't improvement districts at the time, but all of the business associations together. And we actually went down to Trenton, and we testified at different hearings, and we got Jersey City the full range of benefits, which included, among other things, the reduction in sales tax from 6% to 3%, and the opportunity for the money that was collected by the sales tax to be reinvested in the Jersey City business districts. So I want you to know that even before Michael was the president of his business association, he was already a leader in the citywide business organizations fighting for Jersey City's businesses. And he made a difference, again, even before he was the president of the Central Avenue Association. I met Jennifer and him at that time, and they are very attractive, fun, engaging people. And Michael, you can't have a relationship with Michael for more than 5 minutes and not be laughing. I mean, it's just the way things work. Because he was someone who had a real enthusiasm for life, and that communicates immediately to other people in his presence. After I became mayor, and he became the president of the Central Avenue Business Association, we began to work on getting business improvement districts implemented in Jersey City, and the Central Avenue Improvement District was one of the first. And the funds that we got from the Urban Enterprise Zone program were matched by the local business owners, and it allowed for a lot of extra police officers during who were off duty being there. It allowed for us to do improvements on the street front and the block fronts, and the area became much better. But it wasn't, again, just there. What he had done with regard to the UEZ program helped every business district. It helped Journal Square, it helped Monticello Avenue, it helped West Side Avenue, it helped downtown. All of the city was benefiting from what Michael's work had done. Now he did me the honor of serving as my deputy mayor. And you know, we had a number of honorary deputy mayors. They were in pretty much every ethnic community. And again, they were volunteers. But Michael worked on that in a very intensive way. And literally all over, not just Jersey City, but this area of Hudson County, he communicated things that Jersey City was doing to the Korean community. And he made sure that we knew of needs that existed in the Korean community. And that did two things. It brought a lot of Korean investment and engagement in Jersey City from beyond our borders. And it also made sure that Jersey City residents who were here were taking advantage of every program that the city had available to help or provide assistance in some way or another. Again, that was his particular work with the Korean community. But then what was really amazing to me is I later ran for governor, and Michael knew like every Korean in the state of New Jersey. So we would go up to Bergen County, and we'd go down to Middlesex, and we'd go down to Mercer County, and he put together events. And his breadth of relationships was utterly stunning. And I think it has two reasons. First of all, because of his personality, everyone who ever meets him liked him, and they never forgot him. So if he picks up the phone and calls them, people would say, oh, well, this is Michael. Of course, what do you want? I'd be happy to get involved with anything you're doing. And it was really stunning again. Now later, after that, you know, that election didn't go as well as some of my elections here locally, but I think we did very well with the Korean community. But then later, after I was out of office, my wife and I, and Jennifer and Michael, and some friends of theirs also from New York City, we went to Korea together. My wife is here, Jennifer, in the back. We went to Korea together, and we had such a marvelous time. Again, I think I spent the entire trip laughing. And you know, Michael was someone who loves to sing. If you've got a microphone close by and some karaoke going on, Michael's not only gonna be participating, he's probably gonna be the best of all the different participants, because he's actually got a good voice. And again, even when I talk about his personality and you know his enthusiasm, when you're singing and hearing someone singing and they're having a good time, on top of the fact that his voice might be good, it just makes it more fun because of the personality of the person who's singing. And Michael was that way. You know, ultimately, one of the things that also showed who he was when we dedicated the Korean Veterans War Memorial here in Jersey City. We had some folks who were part of the Korean War Veterans Association here locally in Hudson County. They didn't want to pass away and have the forgotten war, as they called it, be forgotten. But they didn't have as great an organizational capability as Michael did. They were good. They reached out to a lot of people. But when they had Michael come on board as a partner in that effort, it was transformative because of his energy. And he had so many Korean Americans get involved. So you went from being something where you had mostly the Korean War Veterans Association of Hudson County to where you had Korean Americans from throughout New Jersey again helping. And now, when every time I go down to the end of Warren Street and I look at the memorial, I think about that. And actually, you know, I'll go and I'll look at the pedestal where you'll see Michael's name together with others who were so pivotal in having the memorial dedicated. And it'll make me think of him. And when I heard that Michael had passed from COVID, I, like everyone else in Jersey City, was devastated. I could never imagine that someone who was so close and who was so energetic and so enthusiastic and vivacious could be struck down like that. You all remember, I think, watching the ceremony by video. I think we all felt sad that we couldn't be there, but we all understood at that time that was at the beginning when everything was closed. But I think all of us, Jennifer, felt very much with you and with the family. And I think everyone who knows Mike still has a very large piece of Mike inside of them. And that's the nice thing. When someone has a life like his, even when he's gone from us physically, he's still with us. In a very big way, we can think of him and it feels as if we were talking to him yesterday. And you have that sense of closeness to him because of how tightly he brought you into his life. I think he's the kind of American that every American ultimately hopes to be. The kind of person who uplifts their community, leaves it better for his life. The kind of person who touches people's hearts. The kind of person who gives us an example of what one person can do. It's a pleasure to remember him today, and we'll remember him forever. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, before we move on with the next name on the list of speakers, I would like to invite Councilwoman Denise Ridley. Do you want to say a few words?
Good afternoon. Today is a day that we remember my friend Michael. Michael was a moving force on this council, as you all know, but he was also a good friend. Michael would always ask me about my family. He would always give good advice. As one of the younger members on the council, I think that Michael felt the need to sometimes take on somewhat of a fatherly role, because he would really delve into my business, right? And he would say, you know, you're young, you're smart, you're successful. Now it's time for you to look for a husband, right? But, you know, I didn't take those things personally, because I knew that Michael was very traditional. And I knew that family was very important to him. And we talked about our families. We talked about his children, his wife. And I really appreciated that about Michael, because it was more than just politics. He really cared for the people that was around him. And so he will always be here in spirit, and we will always remember the great man that he was. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilwoman. Next, Frank Gilmore. Councilman Frank Gilmore, would you like to say a few words?
Good afternoon, everyone. It was very, very hard when we got the news of Michael passing. I was really looking forward to working with him on the council. He's someone who I've admired from afar, just the way how he went about articulating himself, the way he went about advocating for everyday people. It's truly something that deserved to be commendable. I remember one meeting where it was a heated topic on the council, and he felt like people in the audience were not going to understand how he was voting in before he said anything. And he was like, if any one of y'all call me a rubber stamper, we're going to have a problem in here. So for me, just watching how he advocated for everyday people, for the way he advocated for his constituency, the way he paid attention to detail and his love and care for everyday people, it was truly something to be commendable, and it's something that we're all going to miss. To his family and his close friends, we didn't lose him. We gained a legend, and we all have a piece of him in us. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilman Gilmore. The next speaker on our list is a dear friend of mine, also a mentor to me for many years. He is the current president of the Central Avenue SID. Please welcome Sanford Fishman.
Michael Yoon was my friend. We were also business partners on the Avenue. He had his Garden State News was down the block from my family pharmacy, Bond Drugs, and we often would see him on the Avenue. He would stop by on his rounds of checking in with everybody. When he came into the pharmacy, he would take me to the side and tell me about the issues of the day and his take on them. And he always had a way of wanting things done and without making everybody feel that they were being taken care of in a proper way. I just said Michael was sorely missed, and he will always be remembered for his great service to Central Avenue, Ward D, and all of Jersey City constituents whom we served. Thank you.
I would like to invite Charles Yoon, president of the Korean American Association of Greater New York. Please welcome.
As I was just introduced, my name is Charles Yoon. I'm the president of the Korean American Association of Greater New York. Our mission is to look after the Korean American community, to also instill a sense of identity, and also to promote greater civic participation. And I must say, I am awestruck today that we are having this morning and celebration with the mayor, the former mayor, and the city council members of Jersey City, remembering what an incredible hero, what an incredible individual that Councilman Yoon was. Every testimony that I've heard has spoken about his sincerity, his passion, his true love for every person that drove him to have the successful programs and the achievements that he was able to achieve. And that is the pinnacle, that is the ultimate goal that we want to promote to our community members, that everyone will look to Councilman Yoon as a role model. And you can see here today the first generation, second generation Korean American leaders who have come here to pay tribute to Councilman Yoon. Why is that? Because we recognize, just as you have recognized, how hard it was for him as a first-generation person to reach the status and also the impact that he was able to provide to Jersey City and to the community at large. And it is this mission, it is this necessity, this very basic human decency that allowed him to actually gain the love of the residents here, so that before he even ran for office, he was already in their hearts. And so what I would like to say today is to all the community members who are here, yes, we mourn the loss of Councilman Yoon, but we're also incredibly proud of him. And I hope, as we have heard from one of his mentees, the mayor who is here with us today, that his spirit lives on and that each of us here do our best to live up to the ideals that Councilman Yoon has set. Thank you.
Next, please welcome Chang H. Lee, President of the Korean American Association of New Jersey.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Chang Lee from the Korean American Association of New Jersey. I would like to first give my condolences to the family of Councilman Michael Yoon, and thank you for having us. Quite frankly, I did not know Councilman Yoon personally too well, but from what everyone has said here so far, he was a great man. I had known he was great, but I did not know at what heights until today. The amount of impact he had in your community, in our communities, all over New Jersey, possibly in the greater tri-state area. I would like to thank him for all his hard work and what he has done so far. And his work does live on within us. It truly does. Myself, as a second generation Korean American, my belief is truly that he is the role model, the pinnacle role model for what we need to bring ourselves about to strive to be like. We need to do better for our communities, and he has done that so far. He has done that. He has done just that. So, my only regret is I didn't get a chance to know him better, but I truly envy those of you who had such a great relationship with him. I truly do. And all I really can say is that I hope we can all get together and work harder and strive for better goals for our communities together. Thank you.
Next, please welcome Soon Kim, President of the Bethel Industries.
Good afternoon. First, thank you very much, Mayor Stephen Phillip, and staff members for organizing the memorial service. My name is Soon Kim. I'm the President of Bethel Industries in Georgia City. Let me wear a glass so I can read better. It is my great honor to be here today. I'm here to share with you how my husband and I met our dear friend, the late Councilman Michael Yoon. We were able to meet Michael Yoon through my father after Bethel moved to Georgia City in 1999. My father was a very interesting man. He was not only an expert in Korean kites, but also he was dreaming a big dream. He wanted to fly 2,000 Korean kites in the year of 2000 over Hudson River facing the Twin Tower. Actually, my father wanted to promote Korean culture to America. 2,000 Korean kites over the Hudson River. My father had a chance to share his thoughts with Michael. As you know, Michael had a big ear, like an elephant. He paid full attention to the old man's dream. And guess what? My father's dream came true on August 15, year of 2000. That was the day of a Korean Independence Day. Korean kites were dancing over the Hudson River It was fantastic. That was the day of Korean Independence Day. Of course, it was not an easy project. However, with the former Mayor Brett Chandler's help, about 20 people were invited from Korea, including outstanding experts, engineers, and Professor Lee. My husband and I met Michael through this project. He told us two reasons why he helped my father. First, he was sure the project would make Korean immigrants happy. Secondly, but most importantly, he truly believes the project could enable all the people in the state to experience unity in diversity, welcoming new millennium together. Like this, Michael was an advocate who always listened to anyone's little voice. He made an old Korean immigrant's dream come true. His action was priceless. After we watched him closely, my husband and I suggested Michael to run for a city council. He was a capable man, and above all, he was a man of integrity. His response was something unexpected. For some reason, his parents did not want him to be a politician, and he wanted to obey his parents. He was a good son. We call that hyoja in Korean. Finally, Councilman Michael Yun became a politician after his parents passed away. Surprisingly, he became elected a councilman at the town where there were only six Korean votes. I'm sure you all agree that he did his best for a better and healthier community. Councilman Michael Yun always pleaded to the second generation Korean American to have a greater presence in the mainstream politics. We all feel very empty without him. He always shared this conviction. I want to make Georgia City the best town in the States. I'll sacrifice anything and everything for the sake of the people in this community. I see a number of politicians in here, and I thank you very much for all your efforts in leading this community. Let me share with you one last line. I'm sure when leaders right idea can transform this community and the world. Thank you very much.
Thank you. And Councilman Michael would go a mile a minute, and he was hard to keep up with. I see some of his former aides that are here, and I thank them for being here. I'd like to invite his former aide, Vernon Richardson, to come say a few words, please.
Councilman Yoon and his wife, Jennifer. Created a magical place to work in. We had a host of interns from all around the state of New Jersey, the next generation of attorneys and activists and politicians. We had a host of civic volunteers, his civic association members. We had his assistant, Susan, and Iris, The unforgettable Joe number one was a part of it. One of the mayors that was speaking said that family came first for him. What he didn't point out is that he made each and every one of us feel like family. He invited dissent. He would come to caucus meetings and take a point of view. And if anyone in our office took a contrary point of view, he said, have at it. He would invite me to bring in opposition leaders to his point of view to talk to him. Sometimes it would be very surprised by the invite. But he would offer them an opportunity to sway him. And sometimes he would change his mind. Not often. But he would do that. It was a magical place, a special place, a place that I don't envision I'll visit ever again. When I first sat down and talked to him the very first day, he said, Vernon, we do important work, very important work. You may not know this, but I have a bit of an accent. And I don't want you to ever feel inhibited in asking me to repeat myself, because the work is that important. And for the first few months, I had to do that. I had to ask him, what'd you say? And I was always afraid for him, because we had that magical space on Central Avenue, and people would call, people would write, people would email, but people would also walk through that front door and expect to engage with a council member. And I said, wow, man, they're not going to understand what he's saying. But every time, whether he agreed with them or not, whether the issue was large or small, they would walk away content. Because whether they understood the councilman was one thing, but they all walked away recognizing that the councilman understood them. And that's the most important thing you can expect from a leader. He was a complicated man. Very complicated. He was a fierce, impatient fighter for his community. He wanted the change that he thought his community deserved, and he didn't want it tomorrow. He didn't want it today. He wanted it yesterday. Which makes my next comment even that more curious, because the most important lesson I learned from him was I needed to exhibit patience. Patience. He would say, you can't get everything you want today, Vernon. Take what you can, come back tomorrow, and expect to get more. It can't be perfect today. But what I expect from you is to come back tomorrow and the day after and polish it and polish it and polish it until it was perfect. Patience. It's been a long 2-year journey to today. Boss, how is this for patience? Thank you.
Thank you, Vernon. Next, we'd like to invite back Jersey City Philharmonic Orchestra. They'll be performing Amazing Grace.
Thank you. My name is Brian, and I'm the oldest son of Michael. My family and I want to take the opportunity to thank Mayor Fulop, the members of the City Council, the Jersey City Philharmonic Orchestra for that beautiful performance. Today's speakers and all of you for coming out to celebrate my father. We also want to extend a heartfelt thank you
to Christine Goodman and David Diaz for making today's program special. I remember when I was a child walking along Central Avenue with my dad. And this was before he started wearing bow ties. It was very long, yes. He would stop to chat with neighbors and local businesses to say hello. They would discuss how things were going, how families were doing. But what my father would often spend extra time would be to listen to their concerns. And it was clear to me, even at that age, how much he cared for the people of Jersey City, because he worked so hard to address those concerns. My father spent his life building and strengthening the community of Jersey City. He taught me that success is measured not in wealth, but rather our positive impact on others. Clearly, based on what you heard today, he made an impact. He taught me how to work hard. When I was in high school at prep, I look fondly waking up before the sunrise to help my parents open Garden State News. I'd help my father lift bundles of newspapers. I did it in high school. He did it 7 days a week for 35 years. He taught me when to work smarter and not just harder. When I was in college, he shared with me his business experiences and how to invest cents to make dollars. I should have paid my tuition to him. We would have been pretty well off. He taught me the importance of family, no matter how busy he was with work or meeting all the mayors. I never felt that he didn't have time for us or prioritize us. A valuable lesson for me, as now I have three children of my own. One of my favorite memories was coming from Boston to visit and seeing my father's extreme delight in giving his grandchildren a tour. He was showing his favorite people his favorite city. Thank you for allowing me to share with you my father's impact on me. Today's program reminds me why my father loved the city so much, why he loved his community so much. It's because of the people. Thank you.
Benjamin and all their accomplishments. He has certain glow about him when he did. He worked tirelessly to be a role model for his sons and nephews so that he would be as, so they would be as proud of him as he was of them. I want to again thank Jennifer, Brian, Benjamin, and all the Yoon family for their sharing this day with us. There are many other people who wanted to speak here today but not due to time constraints. But thank you to all the speakers and all of you for gathering here. Please join the Yoon family in the rotunda just outside the doors for reception. Continue to celebrate Michael's memory and with your stories. A special thanks to Jung L. Kim, president of the Evergreen Orchid Farm, who is distributing 300 packages of Korean pears. Thank you and have a good afternoon.
And now the end is near, and so I face the final curtain. My friend, I'll say it clear, I'll state my case, of which I'm certain.